we are still on the Punnett square, right? On under the law of segregation. Remember we said law of segregation, it only deals with a single characteristic or trait, right? To show this, Mendel used a mono hybrid cross, right? That is represented by a Punnett square, a square being a square used to determine all the possible outcomes. Now we have made an example of these possible outcomes, right? Made an example of two parents, one being homozygous tall and another one being heterozygous tall. Remember when we said homo means the same, and when a gene is a homozygous gene, it simply means that a gene is made up of alleles that are identical, right? And that gene can also be referred to as a pure breed. It can also be referred to as a pure breed. Now, when we tell you on the exam, this individual is a pure breed, always remember that the alleles are identical. They can be of the capital letter or can be of the small letter. Always remember that. Now, let us carry on. We're still on determination of the possible outcomes. Now, we have determined the possible outcomes, of which simply means that all the individuals that will be reproduced by these two parents, they will all be tall in height. Two of the individuals will be homozygous tall, another two will be heterozygous tall. But it doesn't matter. Always remember, they will be tall, right? They will be tall. Why do we say when we have the small letter T and a capital letter T, again, these individuals will be tall? Remember on our introduction, we said, when we have a capital letter and a small letter, a dominant allele and a recessive allele, there's only one allele that will be physically expressed on the offspring. There's only one allele that will be visible on the offspring. And in this case, remember we said T represents being tall and small letter T represents being short. So this individual cannot be tall and short at the same time. So this individual will be tall. Why? Because there is a capital letter T that masks the short T or the small letter T. And it is the dominant allele that will be physically expressed on the offspring. Meaning there is a possibility that these parents will give rise or reproduce individuals that will all be tall in height. There will be no short individual that will be formed or reproduced, right? Not unless we are facing with a situation of atavism, but let's just forget about atavism. We'll look at it on our next lesson. Right. Now, when having a Punnett square, you have determined all the possible outcomes. You then need to understand or know the genotypic ratio and the phenotypic ratio, right? The genotypic ratio and the phenotypic ratio, right? What is a genotypic ratio? What is a phenotypic ratio? A genotypic ratio, a ratio that shows all the possible outcomes, all the possible outcomes, all the genotypes, right? And then the phenotype, what is physically expressed? How many are tall? How many are short? There is a proportion. We just want to know, out of the four individuals that we have, how many will be tall and how many will be short? Genotype, how many will have the capital letter T, T? How many will have the capital letter T and a small letter T, right? Remember, this gene is not the same as this one, even though they determine the same outcomes, or they determine the same outcomes. Yeah, I can put it that way. They determine the same outcome. Meaning, remember we said this individual will be tall and this one will be tall. But are these the same genes? No, they are not the same. One is homozygous and another one is recessive. Meaning a phenotypic ratio differs from a genotypic ratio. They are not always the same. always bear that in mind, right? Now, let us determine the genotypic ratio of these individuals. Now, genotypic ratio, that is a gene. We speak of genes, something that we cannot see, but we always represent them using letters, right? Now, a genotypic ratio A genotypic ratio of these possible outcomes will just say, out of the four individuals or the four possible outcomes, two of these will have the homozygous gene. Is to remember it is a proportion. And two of these will have the capital letter T and a small letter T. And to simplify this, we can just say one capital letter T, capital letter T is to one capital letter T, small letter T. Why can't we just say four is to zero? We can't say that. Remember, these are not the same genes. One gene is homozygous and another one is heterozygous. So this is our genotypic ratio, right? Genes are always represented by letters, because we cannot see them with our naked eyes. Thank you. Right. Now, let us now try and determine the phenotypic ratio, right? Remember, the phenotypic ratio, it's something that is physically expressed, right? It's something that we can see. Remember, we said all these individuals are tall. We don't even care whether they are heterozygous tall or they are homozygous tall. But at the end of the day, they are all tall. Meaning the ratio or the phenotypic ratio here will be, let me just P and R, but don't write P and R, just write phenotypic ratio, right? Will be 4 tall is to 0, right? 0 being, or 0 mean there is no short individual. There is no way that these parents can give rise or reproduce or give rise to an individual that will be short. All the individuals that will be formed or reproduced, all of them will be tall in height. So I just hope you understand. Always remember the concepts. Always remember the basics. A gene, allele, the laws. Law of segregation, law of independent assortment, right? Remember, we're still on the law of segregation that deals with a single characteristic. To show this, Mendel's used a monohybrid cross that is represented by a Punnett square. So this is how a Punnett square for a monohybrid cross looks like. Remember, we said here we should include the gametes, just to indicate that these are gametes. Gametes, female sex cells or male sex cells that segregate during the formation of gametes or meiosis and recombine during fertilization. This is where they are recombining. This is where they are recombining. They have recombined, right? And remember, when they are recombining, one allele comes from the mother, another one comes from the father. They combine to determine the characteristic or to make up a single gene that will determine a single characteristic. I just hope you are still following. I just hope you're not tired, you're not exhausted, because there's still a long way to go. But the only way to understand genetics, understand the basics, right? Understand the terminology, understand the basics, how to draw a Punnett square, right? How to place on the alleles or genes, how to determine the possible outcomes, as we have done right in this slide. I'm sorry. Right now, let us move. Now, we use different terms to describe a gene for a particular characteristic. We use different terms to describe a gene for a particular characteristic, and how this gene is physically expressed. We use different terms, it's different terms. To describe a gene for a particular characteristic and how this gene is physically expressed. Because at the end of the day, we said it is a gene that determines the characteristic, of which is a characteristic that is visible, that is physically expressed, that we can all see on the outside, right? Now, we use the term genotype to describe the gene for a particular characteristic. So as much as we know that we have genes, or there is a gene that exists, but we don't just call it gene, but we call it a genotype. This is the term that we use to describe a gene for a particular characteristic. We have a genotype that determines a phenotype. We will get there, don't worry, right? Now, what is a genotype? A genetic makeup of an individual that determines the phenotype. Meaning, in this case, we can just say a genotype is an independent variable. Why? Because it determines something. There is a characteristic that depends on a genotype. Do you understand that? Do you get that? Right. Now, we use different terms to describe a gene for a particular characteristic and how this gene is physically expressed. A term for a gene, or a term that describes a gene for a particular characteristic. Another term when this gene is now physically expressed. Because when it is physically expressed, we don't call it a genotype. We can't say that. Because remember, we said a gene, we cannot see it with our naked eyes. That is why we use letters to represent or present a gene or alleles, right? Now, this genotype is defined as the genetic makeup of an individual that determines the phenotype. It determines what is on the outside. It determines what can be seen. It determines what is visible on the outside. Now, what we see is determined by something that is hidden. That is a gene, but we don't just call it a gene. But a term used is called what? A genotype that is represented by letters. Right. Now, when this gene is physically expressed, remember, it's a gene that controls what is outside, what is on the outside, or what we see, what is visible. When this gene now is physically expressed on the offspring, that gene is no longer referred to as a genotype, right? But we now can say we have a phenotype. Do you understand? Different terms are used to describe a gene for a particular characteristic and how this gene is physically expressed, right? We use the term genotype to describe a gene for a particular characteristic. But when this gene is now physically expressed, we have a black color, we have a red color, we can see that this individual is tall. We don't say it, we have a genotype, but we say we have now a phenotype. Why? Because this gene has been physically expressed. It is now visible. Do you understand? It is now visible. So we use two terms, a genotype that is represented by letters, but when this gene is now physically expressed, we say we have a phenotype. Why? Because it is visible, right? A black color. This animal is black. That is a phenotype. It's not a genotype. Because you can't just say, this animal is BB. No, we can't say that. We need to put in weights. And a phenotype is put in weights. Please know that. A phenotype is put in weights. It has to be in weights. So you need to know and understand the difference between a genotype and a phenotype. A genotype is represented by letters. A phenotype is put in weights. This animal is black. This animal is tall. This animal produces high milk production. This animal is white. This animal is brown, this animal is gray, that is a phenotype. Now, this will give you a better understanding on the phenotypic ratio and the genotypic ratio. Phenotype being put in words and genotype being represented by letters. I just hope that you understand and we are still together. Please do not sleep. Do not sleep, drink that water. You need to stay hydrated. You need to think. Right? Let us continue. Let us move. Remember, we are still on the two laws. Mendel's two laws. Law of segregation that deals with a single characteristic and another one. Right? Another characteristic or another law that is the law of independent assortment. Now, the law of independence. The law of independence. Law of independent assortment, right? This law comes after the law of segregation, where Mendel's wanted to understand and have a better understanding on how genes are inherited, whether there is a gene that is an influence on how another gene is inherited, right? Now, remember the same strategy. We need to state the law. We need to understand the law, right? Now, law of independent assortment. It states that pairs of alleles for different characteristics, they segregate. Kambe, what do we mean by the word segregation? What is to segregate? It is to separate. At the end of the day, these alleles, they need to separate so that they can recombine. The allele from the mother can recombine with the allele from the father to make up a gene that will determine a characteristic. Now, let us move. Now, law of independent assortment states that pairs of alleles for different characteristics segregate or separate during the formation of gametes or meiosis and recombine during fertilization. Now, does that symbolize that this law is the law of independence? No. Let us start afresh. Law of independent assortment. It states that pairs of alleles segregate independently. Right? The law of independence. Independently during the formation of gametes. And recombine independently during fertilization. Right? Now, Mendel's in this law is using now two different characteristics. And these characteristics, they are not related at all. They are not related. So he just wanted to find out, is there any gene that is an influence on how another gene is inherited? So he just wanted to find out, right? Is there an influence? Is there an effect? He just wanted to prove that, right? Now, on this law of independent assortment, this law proves that when it comes to inheritance, there is no gene that has an influence on another gene, on how this particular gene or specific gene is inherited, right? Being dark or being black as an animal does not necessarily mean that you will be tall in height, right? Being white as a farm animal does not necessarily mean that you will be short. We do have animals that are black and tall. Some are black and short. We do have animals that are white and tall. Some are white and short, of which tells you that each and every gene is inherited independently. There is no gene that has an effect or an influence on another gene or on the inheritance of another gene. Do you understand? Do you understand? There is no gene that has an influence on how another gene is inherited. Right? Let us continue. Right. Now, this law of independent assortment, the law of independence, we have only independent variables. They are independent. No one depends on another, allele or gene. Right. This law of independent assortment, it only deals with two different characteristics. And these characteristics are not related at all. Right? Now, our main example, we can speak of the fair color, right? And the presence or absence of horns, whether the animal will have horns or the animal will be hornless or polled, right? The presence or absence of horns or an animal will be hornless or polled. Another term for hornless is called polled. If an animal has no horns, it is polled, right? A fair color is another characteristic that is determined by another gene or a gene or a different gene. And horns being another characteristic that is determined by another gene, meaning we are dealing with two different genes that determines two different characteristics. Now, to prove the outcomes, Mendel's used the dihybrid cross. To present the outcomes, Mendel's used the dihybrid cross. Now let us take a look on how the dihybrid cross looks like and how does it differ from a monohybrid cross. Right, this is how a dihybrid cross looks like. Now let us look at our examples. Now we have parents, we have F1 generation that was reproduced by parents or formed by parents, and we have F2 generation. Remember, we are dealing with the two characteristics that are determined by two genes and these genes that are not related, right? Meaning if we have two genes that determines two different characteristics, how many alleles do we have? How many alleles do we have? Just use that basic knowledge, that intro. How many alleles do we have? It's two genes that determines two characteristics that are different. Now, how many alleles do we need? How many alleles do we have? Four alleles. Remember we said a gene or a single gene is made up of how many alleles? Two alleles. One from the mother, another one from the father. Right. Let's get into our example. Right. Here we have the father that is black in color. Let's just say daddy is black. Let's just say daddy is black. We have the father. And we have the mother, right? These are the two parents. Remember, we are on law of independent assortment, dealing with two different characteristics, right? Determined by two genes. Now, right, we have a gene for fair color, another gene for the presence or absence of horns, right? And on the second individual, which is the mother, a gene for fair color, another gene for the presence or absence of horns. Now, let us do this. Right. Let's just say black, the capital letter B, represents the dominant allele, is dominant. And it represents the black color. Right. The small letter B represents the white color, right? And then also, please do not be confused. And I'm sure you're asking yourself, why do we represent white as small letter B? Remember the same rule. When we have genes or a gene that is heterozygous, one being the capital letter, another one being the small letter, the capital letter suppresses, it masks the small letter, meaning this one will be visible. Even when we are writing our genes, we don't just say B and W when we have a recessive gene and a dominant gene. We'll just represent a dominant allele with a capital letter and a recessive allele with a small letter, just to represent that this allele is not dominant, meaning it will not be physically expressed. Right. It bows. Right. Now, we are still on color. Now, this is a single characteristic. Now, capital letter H represents an animal with horns, right? and then a small H, an animal that is hornless. You remember when we said an animal that is hornless can also be said to be polled. It is polled. It has no horns. Right. Now we have this. It's capital letter B that represents the dominant color. Right. Small letter represents the recessive white. And then capital letter H represents horns or the presence of horns. Small letter H represents the absence of horns, of which is we can just say hornless or polled. An animal is hornless or polled. Now, these are the parents that we want to breed, we want to produce or reproduce the F1 generation. Now, on these parents, number one, remember the laws. Each parent has to donate with a single allele, right? For each gene. Since we are dealing with the two characteristics, we have two genes, right? One parent has to donate with a single allele and donate with a single allele for a different characteristic. I just hope you understand. If you don't understand, please do not hesitate to raise up your hand. Remember, we are in class. At the end of the day, you are expected to understand. At the end of the day, you will be writing the examination. So exams are coming. Remember the prelim. Remember the final examination. So never hesitate to ask questions if there is a part that you are not understanding. Remember, it's not about me, it's about you. At the end of the day, you need to learn. At the end of the day, you need to understand and be able to formulate and draw and apply the knowledge on the exam, right? Now let us continue. Now we have two parents. One parent has two genes. One gene for a different characteristic, of which is the fair color. Another gene for a different characteristic, of which is the presence or absence of horns. Remember, we said a big B, dominant H, or a capital letter H, is dominant as well. Now, right, parent number one, of which is the father, is homozygous dominant with black in color. Right, for another characteristic, he's also homozygous with horns. Right, remember homozygous, it simply means two alleles are identical. Right, and then when it comes to the mother, mommy is homozygous also, but not homozygous dominant, but homozygous recessive. Right, and then on another characteristic, when it comes to the presence or absence of horns, mama or mother is homozygous hornless. Mother or mommy has no horns. Mommy is hornless. Mommy is polled. Now, let us try and figure that out. Now, you can either use a Punnett square, okay, you can just use a FOIL method. Just to simplify and to fast forward the process, we can just use the FOIL method. Now, let's just say we have, right, two individuals. Parent one, father. Parent two, the mother, right? This is parent one. This is parent two. Right. Now, remember the law. Same techniques. The alleles need to segregate. Remember, at the end of the day, one parent has to donate with a single allele, right? These, they need to separate or segregate. They are now segregating, right? This one has to segregate as well. They are now segregating during the formation of gametes. Why is it important for alleles to segregate? So that there's going to be a recombination of genes during fertilization. They need to recombine. An allele from the mother need to combine with an allele from the father to form a gene that will determine a specific or a particular characteristic. By looking at these alleles or genes, we can see that all offsprings or the F1 generation will all be the same, right? How so? We can just number these alleles 1, 2, 3, four. One, two, three, four. Now, remember we are dealing with a Punnett square and we are dealing with a dihybrid cross. Remember we said this is how a dihybrid cross looks like. Now, when crossing these, right, before fertilization, capital letter B will work with capital letter H, capital letter B, capital letter H, capital letter B, capital letter H, capital letter B, and capital letter H. Now, to make it easier for you at home or in the class to understand this concept, you can just start numbering your alleles, right, so that you can combine them. And our very easy and very simplified method of combining these, you can just apply the method called 13, 14, 23, 24, right? Remember, in this case, you are still trying to determine the combination of the combination of alleles, right? How these alleles will look like before fertilization, right? We have 13, 14, 23, 24, right? That is why we have capital letter B, capital letter H, capital letter B, capital letter H, etc., etc. Now, the same method on the other side. Small letter B, small letter H, small letter B, small letter H, small letter B, small letter H, small letter B, and small letter H. Now, when these are recombining, when these are recombining during fertilization, you can even see that all individuals in the F1 generation will all be the same. They will all be the same, right? Let's just make an example using a monohybrid cross, a gamete. Let's just say we have BH and BH here. We have small letter H, small letter B, small letter H, small letter B, small letter H. Now, when crossing these or when combining these or recombining these during fertilization, we will have capital letter B, small letter B, capital letter H, small letter H. And all these individuals for F1 generation will be the same. They will all be the same. They will all be the same, meaning all individuals will all be black and with horns. They will all have horns. Now, in this case, genotypic ratio will be the same. Phenotypic ratio will be the same. Not unless we can then decide to interbreed or to interbreed these individuals of the F1 generation to produce the F2 generation. Right? Now, how do you do that? Right? Let's just say we have the individuals from the F1 generation. We are interbreeding them. We want inbreeding to take place. Right? Let's just say on the F1 generation, we have capital letter B, small letter B, capital letter H, small letter H, doing an inbreeding with another individual that is capital letter B, small letter B, capital letter H, small letter H. Now, we are trying to figure the gametes, right, for the F2 generation. Now, remember the same technique. We are numbering these alleles. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Remember, you still need to combine them before transferring them on the Punnett square. Now the technique, 13, 14, 23, 24. Now the same individual, we are just aligning the alleles. It's gonna be capital letter B, capital letter H, that is your 13, your 14, capital letter B, small letter H, your 23, small letter B, capital letter H, your 24, small letter B, small letter H, right? You are just arranging your alleles, right? Mm-hmm. And in this case as well, it's the same thing. 13, 14, 23, 24. Capital letter B. Let us say it together. Capital letter B. Capital letter H. Capital letter B. Small letter H. Small letter B. Capital letter H. Small letter B. Small letter H. So these are our allels that will place them on the Punnett square, right? Now, these are the very same allels, right? These ones are the same as these gametes on the Punnett square. Now we are just placing them on our dihybrid cross. Now remember, this space is for gametes. Just write gametes here. It's very important. It is a mark. You need to represent, or you need to write gametes in there. And then after, we can just combine the alleles to form these genes that will determine these different characteristics. Now, write this BH over here, this BH over here, this one here, and the other one here. Same thing on the side. This one here, this one here, this one here, and another one here. Now we can just start recombining them. Let's just think or make an assumption that these ones are mating, right? There is reproduction taking place. Now, when recombining these alleles, when these alleles combine with these ones, we'll have capital letter B, capital letter B, capital letter H, capital letter H. These with these ones. I mean, these with these ones. Capital letter B, capital letter B, capital letter H, small letter H. Right? This and this. Capital letter B, small letter B, capital letter H, capital letter H. Remember, we cannot write the small b, the small letter b, before the capital letter b. Remember, it is the capital letter that masks the small letter. It is the dominant allele that masks the recessive allele. So never make that mistake. But when it comes to different characteristics, you can just write small letter b, capital letter h, because b and h are not related. Remember, they are determining different characteristics. Law of independent assortment. They segregate independently and recombine independently. There is no gene that is an influence on another gene, on how this other gene is inherited, right? And then let us continue. This and this, capital letter B, small letter B, capital letter H, small letter H, right? This and this, capital letter B, capital letter B, capital letter H, small letter H. This and this, capital letter B, capital letter B, small letter H, small letter H. This and this, capital letter B, small letter B, capital letter H, small letter H. This and this, capital letter B, small letter B, capital small letter H, small letter H. This and this, capital letter B, small letter B, capital letter H, capital letter H. This and this, capital letter B, small letter B, capital letter H, small letter H. This and this, capital letter B, small letter B, B, capital letter H, H. This and that, small letter B, small letter B, capital letter H, small letter H. This and that, capital letter B, small letter B, capital letter H, small letter H. This and that, capital letter B, small letter B, small letter H, small letter H. This and that, small letter H, small letter H, capital letter H, small letter H. This and that, small letter H, small letter H, small, I mean small letter B, small letter B, small letter H, and another small letter H. So these are the possible outcomes for the F2 generation, only if the parents were homozygous, whether homozygous dominant or homozygous recessive, right? I just hope you understand, and we are still together, and yeah, let us move. Now, also, before we move on with our lesson, always remember to be able to determine the genotypic ratio and the phenotypic ratio. Remember, the genotypic ratio is different from a phenotypic ratio. Genotype is represented by letters and should be the same letters, not the same, we mean like BB. It should be capital letter BB or small letter BB. Once one capital, letter is a capital letter, right? Another one is a small letter that is not the same gene, that is a heterozygous gene. I hope you understand, right? Now let us move to phenotypic ratio. Phenotypic ratio, it is the same. Remember, even if the gene is heterozygous black or homozygous black, at the end of the day, black will always be black. There is no black that is different from another black. So black is black. Being tall, tall is tall, short is short, right? Right. I hope you understand that. Now, we are done with the two laws, law of segregation that deals with a single characteristic and law of independent assortment that deals with two different characteristics, right? Being determined by two different genes that are not related at all, right? Now, these characteristics are different. Yes, we know they can be passed on from generations to generations. They can be transmitted from generations to generations, be passed on from parents to offspring. But understand that these characteristics are different, right? We have two types of characteristics. One being quantitative. We have quantitative characteristics. And we also have qualitative characteristics. As much as they are all referred to as characteristics or traits, but they are different. How so? Now, a quantitative characteristic or characteristics that are referred to as quantitative. Number one, they are determined by multiple genes. And these genes are said to be polygenic. They are determined by multiple genes. And these genes are said to be polygenic, right? And these characteristics that are quantitative, they cannot be categorized, meaning they are continuous, right? Best example of a quantitative characteristic, weight, height, horns length, right? Height or weight. Let's just make an example with weight. Some animals weigh 10 kg, some weigh 20 kg, some 50 kg, some 60 kg, some 68, some 90, some 200, some 300. This simply tells us that we cannot categorize the quantitative characteristics. We cannot categorize them. They are continuous, meaning they move from one extreme to the other. And they take on a complete range of forms. That is why we have animals that are of different weights, right? That vary or that move from one extreme to another. Those are quantitative characteristics, right? And then the quantitative characteristics can be influenced by the environment. They can be influenced by the environment, such as weight. When you do not feed your animals, when you do not give or provide your animals with a balanced ration, they will lose weight. They will start producing less. Even if they do have genes that are dominant, right? Genes that can give them high production. But if you do not provide them with a good nutrition, they will lose weight. And when there is when they've lost weight, they will start producing less. Quantitative characteristics are even influenced by the environment, right? Now, qualitative characteristics. Some characteristics or traits are referred to as qualitative. Now, these qualitative characteristics, they are determined by a single or few genes, right? And they can be categorized. Best examples of qualitative genes being discontinuous. Number one, the presence or absence of horns. It's either an animal has horns or it has no horns. It cannot be in between. It's either they are there or they are not there. Second example of a qualitative characteristic, gender, right? Gender can be categorized. It's either an animal is a female or an animal is a male. There is no in between. We can't just say an animal is a full in between male and female. We can't say that. Meaning those characteristics, we can categorize them, right? Another characteristic that falls under qualitative is eye color. It can be categorized. It can be categorized, right? So qualitative characteristics, they only show a few clear cuts with no forms in between. It's either an animal is this or that, right? It's either an animal has horns or it has no horns or it is pawed. It's either an animal is a male or it is a female. It cannot be changed by the environment, right? Now, let us move to our activity. Activity number one, right? Mendel was the first person to study how the characteristics are transferred from parents to offspring. Now, 1.1, name the term that refers to the study in the statement above. You need to write that down. Write 1.2, state two of Mendel's laws of inheritance. That is your second question based on number one or on the statement above. Write number two, or your second question will be, in Nguni Khetu, the black color is dominant over the white color. A purebred black bull is crossed with a homozygous white cow, right? 2.1, determine the genotype of the cow, right? 2.2, draw a Punnett square to determine the phenotype of the F1 generation, right? Of the F1 generation, that is 4 marks. Now let us move to our next or the last activity. That is number 3. Study the crossing below and answer the questions, right? You have gametes and we have all the possible outcomes, right? Identify the type of crossing illustrated above. Remember, we are still on number 3, so your answer should be based on that crossing above. Identify the type of crossing illustrated above. 3.2, provide a reason for the answer in question 3.1. Right, 3.3, determine the phenotype of individual 16 with genotype small letter BB, small letter RR. Now let us look at our answers just to check whether you got that one correct. Write our memo or solutions. The first answer for 1.1, that is genetics, which is a study. 1.2, we have 2 laws, law of segregation and law of independent assortment. So here you're not expected to write Mendel's first law or Mendel's second law. Just write law of segregation and law of independent assortment. And for a genotype, that is small letter BB. Remember, genotype is represented by letters, right? For a Punnett square, this is your Punnett square where all possible outcomes or all possible offsprings will be black in color, right? That is your answer, right? 3.1. Where you are expected to identify the crossing, that is a dihybrid crossing. 3.2, why is it a dihybrid crossing? Because it involves 2 characteristics that are determined by 2 genes that are different, right? 3.3, the phenotype for individual number 16, and individual number 16 will be white and smooth, right? Our summary, let's just recap. We learned more about genetics as a topic, definition of genetics, and the passing on of characteristics from parents to offsprings, of which being determined by gene or being determined by single gene. Single characteristic being determined by a single gene. We learned more about different genes, of which is the heterozygous and the homozygous. Homo means the same, hetero means different, meaning homozygous gene made up of none of identical alleles, and then heterozygous gene made up of non-identical alleles. And then we also did the 2 crossings a monohybrid cross that applies using law of segregation, and then dihybrid cross that is applied using the law of independent assortment, right? And then the last one, we also stated the two laws that are applied in genetics, or that were implemented or introduced by Mendel, of which is the law of segregation and law of independent assortment. Now, this is your homework. Go and do this activity at home, and then we'll provide the solutions when we come back, right? So, continuation of your homework. Another questions for homework? Right, thank you so much. Thank you for listening. I hope you have gained something, and I hope you'll be able to answer those exam questions and be able to apply the knowledge, be able to define those terms, be able to do the crossings, and yeah, thank you so much.